comment as such on the learning lecturer's paper, I will try to provide a different perspective just to round out the discussion. Now, when we talk about the role of lawyers in, or the role of the legal profession in nation building, what it always boils down to is ensuring the rule of law, because the rule of law is the bedrock of democracy, and the democratic state cannot survive without it. But let's take a step back and ask ourselves, what exactly is the rule of law? Now, there's a positivist definition that says the rule of law is when you have a known regime of rules which are predictably and effectively applied with equal force to everybody in society, including those persons who promulgated them. However, this is a somewhat limited definition which does not necessarily promote the ideals of democracy. The rules, for instance, may themselves be unjust, discriminatory, or cruel, yet if they are applied predictably, consistently, and equally, you have the rule of law, going by that definition. So we have to look beyond simply the attributes of the rule of law and also look at the content. And I think what most people mean when they talk about the rule of law is a system where there are constraints on the power of the state to deny the rights and liberties of its subjects, a system that regulates harmful private conduct as well as public conduct, and also a system that provides the environment for facilitating orderly trade and commerce. Now, embedded in this rule of law narrative is that the legal profession and legal institutions are best suited in terms of their training, motivation, and structure to advocate for and enforce the rule of law. After all, lawyers advise their clients, be they individuals or state clients, and negotiate and, if necessary, litigate with the state and other private parties whenever claims or rights are impaired or disputed. Now, in theory, lawyers also assist in building the legal institutions and culture of the rule of law under the supervision of an independent judiciary. The legal profession helps to promote the norms of respect for, habitual resort to the law, and obedience to legal authority. Now, I say in theory, because that isn't quite what happens in practice. In practice, lawyers profit from delay and complexity, which makes vindicating rights uncertain, costly, and slow, and which usually favors the rich who can afford their services. It is true that the courts are open to all classes of litigants, but in practice, poverty-stricken citizens can neither hire a lawyer nor rely on state-supported legal aid to protect their rights. In other words, poverty often deprives citizens of the benefit of the rule of law. And as the learned lecturer pointed out, in Nigeria, delays are endemic, and cases sit on the dockets for years, sometimes decades, which also adds to their cost. Attempts at law reform have been made to address this problem, but the reforms are resisted by the bar itself. And sometimes judges at best seem to be too timid to enforce discipline. Justice delayed is justice denied, we're all familiar with that expression. So is it any wonder then that poor citizens often resort to self-help and violence in the resolution of their disputes, which is in itself the very negation of the rule of law? So there's an inherent contradiction which exists between the supposed role of the legal profession in ensuring the uniform application of all rules to citizens, and the real business of lawyers, which is to interpret the rules in ways that favor their particular clients. That is the job of the lawyers on the opposing sides of an issue. You have the same set of legal rules, each lawyer interprets those rules to favor their clients. That is what they're supposed to do. This is meant to be mitigated by the judiciary, who serve as the impartial arbiter who resolve the varying interpretations of the law proffered by the lawyers appearing before them in an authoritative and fair manner. But what happens when the judiciary is corrupt? An independent, corrupt-free judiciary is vital to ensuring a system where the legal framework is applied impartially without fear or favor. Judicial corruption undermines the rule of law because it simply means that the corrupt, powerful, well-connected, and wealthy effectively purchase justice from corrupt judges, and in the minds of the ordinary citizen, justice goes to the highest bidder. Government interference is also a form of corruption, which takes away from the independence of the judiciary. We're all aware of the different stories which are found of governmental interference with the judiciary, and it is notable that while government officials always pay lip service to the notion of judicial independence, the fact is that a corrupt or weak judiciary is to the advantage, oftentimes, or is seen or perceived to be to the advantage of the party in power, which can and often does seek to use the judiciary to achieve its political objectives. Now, we know that one of the primary roles of the legal profession in upholding the rule of law is the protection of the rights and freedoms of people from an overreaching state. In Nigeria, there have been some lawyers, some of whom I see sitting here today, both on the podium and in the audience, who have taken it upon themselves to promote the common good and advocate fiercely for the poor and downtrodden. More lawyers and the Bar Association itself have played a prominent role in resisting authoritarian regimes, as we may recall when we cast our minds back to the role of the legal profession in the pro-independence movements against colonial rule and the pro-democracy activists in the area of military rule. However, in general, it must be said, lawyers and the Bar and Bar Associations tend to be politically conservative, only joining in the defense of the underdog and subordinate groups after the activist few have succeeded in bringing the issues to the forefront of public consciousness. In this regard, I cast my mind back to the, I'm not just talking about Nigeria, I cast my mind back to the Bar in South Africa, which was very apathetic on the issue of apartheid until civil society had brought the issue to the forefront of the public debate. More often than not, the dominant interest of lawyers has been in establishing and protecting reliable sources of fees and protecting professional privileges. As one commentator put it, lawyers in general have the most social sympathy with those who can pay their bills and have little time or patience for anybody else. The rule of law is often promoted as a necessary precondition for ensuring a well-functioning market in which property rights are respected, contracts enforced, and economic opportunity and mobility for the citizenry are assured. You would have thought that this is the one area where the legal profession would have excelled. But even as faithful representatives of business clients, lawyers oftentimes do not live up to this ideal and do disservice to the rule of law. After all, the main interest of a lawyer is in securing good deals and favorable treatment for clients, and not necessarily in producing efficient rules that enhance the functioning of the market. In some instances, the client itself may not be interested in the rule of law, but prefers a system of ad hoc corrupt deals in which the lawyer serves as its agent to obtain favorable treatment from the state. We all know of instances where the legal profession can so overreach itself in the service of business clients that it leads to moral revulsion and general backlash from the public. And the one case that I recall is, again, not in Nigeria, but in the United Kingdom, where there's been a backlash against perfectly legal tax avoidance schemes, but which the general public perceive as distorting the market, to the extent that the government has been able to bend the arms of corporations such as Google and Apple to pay more taxes than, in fact, they are legally required to do. Now, while I may have sounded very critical of the legal profession in this presentation, I'm only trying to offer a different perspective so that we can look at not only the successes which the lecturer highlighted in his presentation, but also some of the failures. And we must also never lose sight of the fact that lawyers in most emerging economies have to contend with a myriad of problems that their counterparts in more developed economies do not have to deal with. Take general insecurity, for instance. We are all familiar with the state of insecurity in Nigeria, ranging from the predations of ethnic militias, vigilante groups, religious insurgents, and criminal elements, which are oftentimes exacerbated by the ineffectiveness and sometimes complicit involvement of the police and other law enforcement agencies. As one scholar has noted, lawyers are especially ineffective in a dystopian environment where violence replaces social dialogue and extra-legal measures become the preferred mode of conflict resolution, where disaffected minority groups view violence as an acceptable means of pressing their case for inclusion, and where the rule of law and social order it sustains have been dethroned and supplanted by jungle justice. Lawyers also have to contend with judicial corruption and government interference in cases, often overlooked, but of particular concern, which is something our Honorable Chairman just pointed out, the prevalence of deteriorating public institutions, which are so dysfunctional, corrupt, and unpredictable that it becomes almost impossible for lawyers to ensure that their clients' transactions are carried out in conformity with the rule of law and without regard to political connections, ethnic background, or economic status. So while we may exhort the legal profession to play a heroic role in enforcing the rule of law, we must nonetheless recognize that there are myriad systemic issues which are not within the control of the legal profession and which have the effect of inhibiting its role. Now, of course, the legal profession cannot lift up its hands in collective despair and do nothing. As a learned lecturer said, the whole purpose of the legal profession is to uphold the rule of law. He's proffered some solutions. I'm not going to run through a whole gamut of solutions or repeat things he has said, but I would just like to focus on two important instances where the legal profession has a role to play, and this is in the area of promoting accountability and promoting access to justice. Lawyers must be at the forefront of promoting efforts to curb the excesses of corrupt and abusive leaders. We all witness the impact of activist lawyers in opposition to military rule. The assumption appears to have been that the struggle to hold leaders accountable ended with the creation of political parties and institution of elections. But elections do not in and of themselves ensure a functioning democracy, justice and equality before the law, or respect for human rights. Lawyers can be most effective in upholding the rule of law by creating the ideological framework that galvanizes civil society to hold leadership accountable, creating the dialogue, shaping the narrative, identifying inadequacies, and proffering solutions. Within the profession itself, lawyers have a primary role to play in curbing judicial corruption. The bar can play a role in not only determining the underlying factors that lead to corruption and pushing for their resolution, but also in examining methods of more effectively identifying judicial misconduct and punishing corrupt judges. And the bar must also be resolute in punishing lawyers who participate in the corruption of the judiciary and barring them from the profession. The legal profession must also make a concerted effort to tackle the problem of lack of access to justice occasioned by poverty and illiteracy. The federal legal aid system is poorly funded and resourced and is only available in a limited number of criminal and civil cases. And I think more recently it extends to cases for the enforcement of fundamental human rights. The organized bar could, for example, push the legislature to extend the scope of legal aid. Lagos State has shown what can be achieved at the state level when it established the Office of the Public Defender, which handles a much broader range of matters. In addition, the organized bar could do much more to promote a structured framework for pro bono activities on the part of its clients. I have some ideas on that, but I don't think I have enough time to elaborate on them. So in conclusion, the fact of the matter is that a lot is expected of the legal profession in contributing to the building of a nation that is stable, democratic, peaceful, prosperous, and inclusive. Of course, the legal profession cannot be the only actor on this stage, and much also depends on the strengthening of public institutions and administrative agencies so that they are strong enough to withstand corruption or capture by powerful interests. Civil society also has an important role to play. But the legal profession has a unique role to play by virtue of its training and orientation in being at the forefront of developing ideas and strategies for identifying and improving inadequacies in the legal system, strengthening the judiciary, providing access to justice, and providing the ideological framework to resist tyranny and abuse. Thank you very much.